And we are live. So this is going to be an interesting one. And let me close this window real quick because it's raining out, which means that there's going to be a lot of noise from the street. But yeah, this is going to be an interesting one because this one's kind of on you folks. I see that we have a few people here in the chat. This is your opportunity to ask pretty much anything you want. I'm kind of doing this as an ask me anything, I will answer to the best of my ability. Obviously, like I'm thinking or assuming that a lot of the questions would be around game design, but they don't have to be. Like, if you want to ask about the writing, the night stuff, whatever you want, you get to dictate how this talk is going to go. Of course, that also means that if there's not questions, then this is going to be a really short video. But there's oftentimes where people have questions and they have things that they specifically want to bring up, and sometimes I'm able to touch on them lightly. And I just figured that would be interesting to give you an opportunity specifically dedicated to answering questions. So that's kind of what I'm going to do. And I'm stalling a little bit. And hello, everyone. Ryan B., Jared, Lanier. Good to see you all. Just to give some time to get the questions in there. Plus, we're going to do the usual thing of talking about updates, the status of things, just to eat up some time. How are things going with Linvander? Well, they're progressing. I mean, we are hard at work. It's really strange a lot of the times because a lot of my work is done. And then I forget about things because they go over to Josh. Because a lot of the artwork and a lot of the layout stuff happens after I am finished, and after like I finish editing the rule book, and way after I finish the rules and whatnot, and we've done all of our testing, there is still a lot of stuff that needs to be done on his plate. So I'm usually not the best one in terms of being able to answer like where projects are when they're near the finish line, because oftentimes I don't even know. But I know that we're putting plans together about how we're going to roll out Gaskinese, and Gemini Gauntlet, I believe, is also almost there. Josh was saying he was hoping he'd finish that this week. I think he might already have done so, which would be awesome. I'm really excited to get that game out there. It looks really cool. It really, really does. Like Gaskinese, I'm really proud of because of the gameplay and all of the missions that I created. Gemini Gauntlet also just looks really cool. These are two games that I'm really excited to get out there. Obviously, we are still working on Divinity. That's going to be a continuous project. I mean, there's a lot of content in there, a lot. Like, I think I have actually written fewer words when I've written a book than is going into Divinity. And the crazy part is how little of it will get read on any one single playthrough, percentage-wise, just because of the way the game works and you have to choose a path versus other things. So that's kind of interesting. I am still hard at work on Werewolf, trying to get everything, like the rules are done. Josh went through the rules, found a few things, corrected them, and tweaked them, and now just need to get the first play test of it. That's exciting. That's a very exciting time to happen because that's the first time that it becomes real, even if it, at least when I design protos, isn't going to look very pretty. It's going to be a bunch of spreadsheets. Have some thoughts and whatnot taken down for Vampire and Wraith as well, and also following a general template for those games so that they all feel very similar. So, yeah. So, projects are definitely moving and there's a lot of work. I've actually been really hard at work the last week or so on something not Linvander related, but with my writing career. And I can't talk about it. Sorry. But it is another book. And it's a book that I'm being contracted to write. And trust me, when I can talk about it, you will definitely know. All right. So let's get to some questions. I think that gives you the general update. Standard statement supply of if you have any questions about any of our projects, please ask. I am more than willing to share. But now let's look at what you have thrown over in the chat that I have been deliberately ignoring. Actually, I've been mostly ignoring it because as soon as I saw Jared's boxers or briefs comments, I was like, all right, I have to ignore this because some questions might come up that might make me smile or distract me. So I did say, ask me anything. So I actually wear boxer briefs. There you go, Jared. Now you know. Now the whole internet knows, anyone who watches this video. But I did say ask me anything. Plus, I have no shame, so it really doesn't bother me to share that information. Okay, B asks, how long did it take for my first game? Well, the question is, what do you mean by how long did it take? How long did it take for me to develop my first prototype of it? How long did it take for me to get it my first game published, which was my first like published game? Like there's multiple things here. The first game that I have created has not actually been published yet. One of these days, I want to go back to it and work on it because of how much I've learned through the process. But the first game that I created was primarily a game about running a corporation. And it had a lot of math because, and this is what I need to go back and fix, but it had a lot of math and a lot of buying and selling of stock. And you could do things like you could buy out a company if somebody sold too much of their stock, or you could go the science route and like research a bunch of stuff to get the win that way. Or you could like go the underground route of building up a military force and taking over someone's company that way. And so it had a lot of those elements involved. And that game actually led to. I showed that game to Catalyst because since it was all about running companies, all this mischievous double dealing and backstabbing and stuff like that, I figured it would be perfect for Shadowrun. And it led to them really respecting my game design chops because they really liked it, but they didn't want it to be the first Shadowrun board game. They wanted the first Shadowrun board game to be about being runners. So they actually let me then pitch a different game. Which then eventually became Shadowrun's Problems. Now, the how long did it take for me to build that prototype? The entire first draft of the prototype for that game took me about one day to design, a few hours, because I was working and it was pretty much an in the evening. It took me one game to design, which basically is that where I write everything on my giant whiteboard. And then in about the next evening, so another day, I wrote the rules. And then it took me about a week to develop the proto. All told, let's say it took me about 2 weeks to create a playable prototype. Now, then it took several months, mainly because of the fact that it was hard to get people together to play test it. And at the time, I didn't feel comfortable enough to play test it on my own, like I do with a lot of games these days. So it was a very, very long time to go through playtest iterations before I felt comfortable putting it in front of Catalyst. And that I would say took me about 6 months. And then it got to the state where they were happy with it. And like I said, that conversation happened. If that conversation hadn't happened, if they had already done some Shadowrun board games, there is a possibility that game would be out now. I don't know. Like I said, personally, I want to go back and revisit it, mainly because I think that I can simplify the math portion, which is what slowed people down a lot in testing. So, yeah. But anyway, first game ever took me about 2 weeks to get a playable proto, and then took me about 6 months to get it clean enough to put in front of a publisher, or at least what I thought was clean enough. Okay, so next question, Lanier. Have I played the Skyrim mod and Enderal and Enderal? You're in the middle of it. Fantastic story. Right, I have to admit something here. I have not played any Skyrim mods. Yep, true story. I have not played any of them. I have played Skyrim all the way through from beginning to end. But I have not played any of the big mods. I don't remember if I did any quality mods at the time because I played Skyrim close to when it came out, so years ago. But I have not played any of the big mods, which are like full-on content, like new levels and everything like that. I usually don't. I used to, and then I stopped. And the reason why I stopped is primarily because of the fact that I got a huge backlog of games. And a lot of the mods, unless you wait until they're reviewed, are hit or miss. Some are amazing, and some you're like, why did I spend a lot of time on this? And so when I got this huge backlog of games, I was like, okay, I'm going to start playing these games. Every once in a while, I go back, but lately I haven't been playing mods a lot because I have such a huge backlog of games and hardly any time to play. Usually something else catches my eye. My other thing is that I play video games like I read books serially. I can't do it in parallel. If I start playing a game, I will play that game until I beat that game or until I decide I'm done with it, which actually took a long time to get to. For a long time, I was determined to beat every game I played. And for a long time, I could actually say that, like when I was a kid back in high school. But and I was determined to beat every single game that I played. I wouldn't let a game beat me. And then later on, when my life started getting busier, I realized if I'm not having fun and I've checked out of a game, who cares if I beat it or not? I don't need this personal pride checkmark that I've beaten every game I've played. I actually think that is a negative check or a minus on my chart if I'm not enjoying the game that I'm playing. And so it just caused this whole new shift. So now I can definitely not say I've beaten every game that I've played. And there are a lot of games that I've played that I went, yeah, no, we're good. But I still have a huge backlog of games. So some games I still want to get every achievement. I still have that addiction. But the games where I want to do that, it's very, very few. And usually I want to do it because I think that it's going to be a new and interesting way to play the game. All right. But I'm glad that you are enjoying the mod, Linear. That is awesome. And I think some of those story-based mods are really cool. And this is going to be like really, really embarrassing if Enderal is this game. But I know that there was a Skyrim mod that's getting created into a full game, which is the whole, like, it was originally a Skyrim mod, I think, where it's this whole story where, like, the entire city gets turned to gold if like one person commits a crime, no matter who it is. And you have a minor ability to travel through time. And basically someone's committing a crime and killing everyone in the city, turning them all into gold, including the person who committed the crime. And so you're trying to like solve the crime before it happens and prevent it from happening. So I forget what the name of that one is, but I know it started as a Skyrim mod. And it's one that caught my interest and I'm going to look for when it came out. So I know that there are some killer mods out there. And I really do hope you're enjoying Enderal because some of the mods are absolutely amazing. All right, next question. Ryan, what theme of game do I prefer and why? So first off, 90% of the time, I prefer a competitive game over a cooperative game. 90% of the time. This is slightly tweaked based on who I am playing with and the moods of the people that I am playing with. For example, one of my good friends, like I actually call them a member of we call them a member of our house, really prefers cooperative games. And so I'd rather play cooperative games with them because I know that they're going to enjoy it more. And my enjoyment is tied to other people's enjoyment when playing a game. If nobody else is having fun in the game, I'm not going to have fun either. So with that caveat out of the way, usually I prefer competitive games. It's just my preference. And what I really, really get into and what I really, really like are the games that have multiple ways to win and the games that have that allow engine building and usually some element of either worker placement or like technology trees or something like that. Those are the type of games that I like, the ones that really get my brain churning and planning 3 or 4 or 5 moves ahead. Those are the types of games that I enjoy, where you set up your strategy and then you have to wait for it to unfold. And sometimes as it's starting to unfold, you need to pivot really quickly because like one of the resources you are counting on is gone or something like that. Brass is a wonderful example of this. I love Brass. It is one of my favorite games because there are so many different ways to win, and you often have to adjust your strategy based on what other people are doing. And that's something that I find really, really cool and really exciting. Lately, I've been enjoying Barrage, which does a similar thing where you can start to win by capitalizing on what other people are doing. The thing that I love about Brass is the fact that you can win the game. You can completely win the game without like ever building any of the technologies, because you are then building the building blocks, the canals and the railroads and things, and like the coal mines that other people are using. Because if you identify that need quickly, you can fill it. And it's just, I like that flexibility. I like when there's multiple strategies involved. And I like those games which have meat on their bones that I really need to dig into and think about what I'm doing. That's my preference of game. Like, usually the games that I enjoy are the ones that take like 2 hours to play at a minimum, depending upon your players. But those are the types of games that I really dig and really get into. So B asks, am I ever satisfied with my own work? That's an interesting one. And that's kind of a trick question, because it's not one that I can actually answer with just a yes or no, even though it's a yes or no question. Because yes, I am satisfied with seeing other people get into it and really enjoy it. Hearing people enjoy something that I wrote, hearing them get into a game that I created or helped create, very exciting, very awesome, very wonderful. I really enjoy that. And at that moment, I'm satisfied. But I always have this voice in my head that's like, oh, I could do it better. Like, I should have done this slightly differently, or the next story I write is going to be even better, or maybe I should have tweaked that, or oh no, there's that part where people are sticking, or I never quite liked how this element mixed together. I'm a perfectionist when it comes to my creations, and it's really hard to just let it go and not keep working on it. It's actually something that is identified as a serious stumbling block a lot of times with writers, is you're determined to make your story perfect before you ever send it out. And because you're determined to make it perfect, you're always working on it and you're never actually putting it out there and like advancing your career or sharing it with people, even if you're just doing it for you, because you're always revising, revising, revising. And games has that same thing. And yes, I'm a perfectionist. So I guess the best way I can answer that question is I am satisfied enough to get it out there and that it brings me happiness when I see other people enjoying it and reacting to it. But I am never satisfied enough that I feel like I couldn't have done better or that there are things that I should tweak or improve. So yes and no. All right. Ryan, if I could work on any IP, what would it be? I'm assuming you mean for board games. And I assume you mean for board games. The two IPs that I would love, hands down love to work on. So there's love to work on for business reasons and because it would be cool. But then there's the like fan favorite personal ones. Like for example, let's just say like Marvel. I love Marvel. Marvel's awesome. It'd be really cool to work on a Marvel movie, but that's not like, oh, that's the one that I definitely want to work on. But business-wise, like, oh my God, that would be amazing, right? That would be like out of this world. If we're talking about like the personal fan favorites, the ones that are close to me, and I'm going to give you a couple, because there's a couple that I would really love to have worked on. And the horrible, horrible thing about this is there are already games in these IPs. That's the horrible part about it. And this is going to sound absolutely conceited, but whatever. I think we, Linvander, could do a better game than is already in these IPs. I really think we could. So that being said, here are some of the top IPs that I would go nuts over. Dark Souls. Oh, I love Dark Souls. Dark Souls, Bloodborne, Demon Souls. Any of those, love them. Love them so much, so dear to my heart. I want to love that board game so much, and I can't. I do have homebrewed rules. I talked about this on an earlier stream that I think will make that game better. But I do keep thinking about, like, oh, I would love to make a Dark Souls game. Absolutely. The other, or the next one on the list of like IPs that I would just absolutely go nuts over, Pacific Rim. Kaiju and giant stompy robots. What's not to like? I mean, that's just, oh, that would be so much fun. And the minis and that would come out with that, and like how that game would look on the board would be phenomenal. I have not played the Pacific Rim board game. When it came out, I saw it and had negative opinions of it when it came out, or when it was on Kickstarter. Like, I really wanted to back it because I love Pacific Rim, but just went, that is my personal opinion on the game. Again, have not played it, but I honestly, I thought it looked a lot like a cash grab rather than like a solid game in and of itself. So, but again, haven't played it. I could be way wrong. I could be way wrong about that, but that's my personal thought. So, Dark Souls, Pacific Rim. That's two IPs that I would absolutely like. I would go nuts over. All right, a third one that I would go nuts over, that again, there's a game already for it. I just think we at Linvander could do so much better, is Mistborn. Love Sanderson's writing. Mistborn or Steelheart. Now, the Reckoner's board game, I really like the Reckoner's board game. I think the Reckoner's board game is really cool. It does some really awesome things. I really enjoy it. I highly recommend it as a cooperative game. It is honestly one that I like to pull out, and I am hugely, hugely happy that I backed it. But that's still, I can't say the same thing about Mistborn, but though that's the Reckoner's board game really does a good job with the Steelheart books. So yeah, those are three IPs that I would just be like, oh, there's a lot of other IPs that I would really, really enjoy. Like Jared, you're right. The Demon Cycle by Peter Brett would be really cool. The Red Rising Cycle by crap. Can't remember his name. It started out as a trilogy and then became five books, but Red Rising was the first one. This is going to bug me, so I'm going to look it up right now. Thank you, Amazon. And you can hear my new keyboard. Pierce Brown. Okay. Yeah, Jared, highly recommend the Demon Cycles series. Really good. Really good. I'm biting my tongue so hard. Oh, I don't want to ruin anything for you. I really don't want to ruin anything for you. After you finish, you can talk to me about it. But I'm going to bite my tongue until you finish. A personal favorite of mine that I would also go nuts over, which is another classic one, is Dune. I love that universe. That universe is awesome. I would go nuts over designing a Dune game as well. Yes, I know that there's a Dune game, and I've heard it's really, really good. But yeah, so those are some IPs that I would like just totally go nuts over. Good to see you, Tommy. Thank you for stopping by. I wasn't ignoring you, I was just in the middle of the thing. Okay. So yeah, that answers your question of some IPs that I would love to work for and would totally go nuts over. So yeah. Any of those would just, yeah, so awesome. All right, so what's our next question? I gotta scroll up now because Tommy showed up and then my chat window got really, really, really long because we all like to say hi to Tommy. So B asked, do I prefer IPs or my own creations? It varies. So here's the thing. If you're talking about my writing, I almost always prefer my own creations because I like to create the world. I like world building. It can frequently get very muddled to have to do IP-based writing because you need to make sure that everything's right. You need to do a lot of research. Not a huge fan of research, I admit it, which is bad because I'm like really logically minded and scientifically minded, but not a huge fan of research. And so it can be very draining to write in someone else's IP. And I really like the world building aspect, so I much prefer writing in my own IP or writing in an established IP where I get to create stuff in the IP. When you're talking about designing board games, though, I don't think I really have a preference. I enjoy both. The nice thing about working in an IP is that I've got an image and a theme that I want to fit into and a mold that I want to fit into. When I'm working completely on my own, the thing is that it's sometimes there's a little bit of the white page syndrome where there is like so where there are so many options that I'm not quite sure which direction I want to go in. And you're kind of stumbling around looking for that little hook. The really nice thing about an IP-based game is that it lets you know already what you kind of want to do. It gives you direction, which can frequently be really, really helpful. So for games, I would say I like both. I wouldn't really say that I prefer one or the other. Okay. Hi, Richard. Welcome, welcome. I'm only now catching up on the chat. And B, you are not slow. We at Linvander are fast. That, like most games, it's usually years. So please do not feel like you are slow. I've always been crazy fast. Like, I earned a reputation as a writer for being a crazy fast writer. My first Shadowrun story, I researched, wrote, edited, and like got edits back from the editor and turned back in a 3 to 4 day time period, which is like unheard of. So yeah, it is not that you are slow. Please. Keep that in mind. Okay. Do, 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 do. All right. So linear. Ender is very involved and interesting. Takes many hours. Yeah. Time poor is a problem. Okay. I need to check out Age of Atlantis on Kickstarter or play around with the TTS. All right. You know what? We're just going to look that up real quick and we're going to leave it in the window because my memory is shot these days. Now it helps if I spell it right. Age of Atlantis. Cool. I will look at that after the stream, but now I have it up. Thank you for the recommendation, Richard. Okay, John, George Lucas said movies are never finished, they're abandoned. Yep, that is so true. I mean, it's the best way that I can think about it is what I frequently say, where it is every artist that I respect has that same problem. Every artist that I respect has imposter syndrome and has the problem of always wanting to improve. That is hands down something that I have seen and run into. I think that that is a definite part of wanting to be really good and always improving your craft. I really think that is a part of it. I think it's unfortunate that it comes with imposter syndrome and it comes with this drive of always feeling like you need to keep getting better, you need to keep getting better. I think it results in some amazing work. I have met some writers, not game designers, but I have met some writers who don't have imposter syndrome, who are very confident all the time in their abilities, and usually that they're all that. And I don't respect them as artists. and sometimes not as people, if I'm being honest. I'm not going to name any names, but it's just, it's a certain element of wanting to improve and realizing that you don't know everything, and realizing that you are still learning and you are still improving. Even experts are still improving. You can be an expert, but you still have to continuously evolve. And I, unfortunately, I think, or at least in my experience with people that I've talked to about it, know well enough to be able to have an opinion. Part of that drive comes from always feeling like it's not good enough and it's not finished, which then imposter syndrome comes with that, which is unfortunate and something that I've been dealing a lot with the last few weeks. Like, I don't know if any of you follow me on Facebook or whatnot, but I made a post there about wrestling with imposter syndrome, especially from being away from things for a few weeks because of things happening in Seattle and then the computer dying and stuff like that. And yeah, I don't know. I try to be very open about the mental and emotional side of things because I firmly believe that it is helpful for me personally to be more open about it. I also believe that it is helpful for others and me to normalize it. And I like to think that it's helpful for other people to see that they're not the only one experiencing these things. So anyway, that was a random aside, and I apologize for that. Not really. I don't apologize for that. You're used to the random asides by now. Either that or you are new and welcome to the stream. And I will tell you, random asides happen a lot on this stream. Not as often as on Tommy's stream. And definitely not as often as our designer diaries when you have all three of us there, but they do still happen a lot here. Okay, back to our questions. So Ryan, do I prefer to play games with just cards, standees, or minis? Well, I will say that I always prefer minis over standees, given the option. I especially if they're good minis, oh, so pretty, so immersive. The cards versus minis depends on the game and the type of game. Let me give you an example. Shogun. Wonderful game. Absolutely love it. There's no minis involved, and it's moving a bunch of armies around on the map. Because of how many armies you are moving at a time, and because of how much information is conveyed, using minis, and we're going to, if you've played it, we're ignoring the whole tower element. There's ways you could fix that anyway. But moving the cubes around on the map makes much more sense than moving minis. Because if those were all minis, it'll get really crowded really fast. There are some games out there that use minis, especially for moving people around on a map, and it can get really crowded really fast. I'm looking at you, Rising Sun. That's not my personal preferred style because then it gets too busy. Now, if you are talking about like having a few minis on the map, then I really like the minis. One of the games where I really like the minis is the Village Attacks games. I love the minis in those games. I think they're awesome. I think they add a lot to it. I think that they look really cool. Really glad that I backed that as a Kickstarter as well. So that's a game where I really enjoy the minis. But sometimes I don't necessarily want minis because I just want to convey information. Another perfect example of this, Edge of Darkness. I mentioned it a couple of weeks ago because I finally got it and I was really looking forward to playing it. And you know, it's the Kickstarter edition, so it comes with all the bells and whistles. And I love the game. Played it again, loved it. It was just as good as I remembered. Actually, better than I remembered because I didn't remember it super well from BGG, and I'm really glad that I picked it up. However, because I did the pre-order Kickstarter version, all of the agents are a resource that you have that you spend in the game. You like train up agents and you get them and then you use them and put them on locations to get special abilities. And I was like, okay, cool. But I actually don't like the fact that those are minis. I think that would be easier if they were just tokens. And I'm actually kind of kicking myself a little bit. And this is totally my fault. It's not AEG's in any way. They actually give you, if you did the Kickstarter version, both the tokens and the minis. And I honestly went, why am I going to hold on to these tokens? I'm going to save space in the box, chuck the tokens, recycle them, and actually I still might have them. Now that just got me thinking. I keep a little box of game components I'm not using for the game itself for when I do prototyping. And I might still have the tokens in there because I might have saved those. Like I always save like the money tokens and stuff like that because those are a pain in the butt to prototype. And so it's useful to just be like, hey, here's a bag of money, done. But anyway, what I was going to say was I thought that I had tossed them. And if I had, I'm kicking myself a little because it's actually easier in that case to use tokens. Anyway, so it really depends on the game, which one I would prefer. But usually if it's the kind of game where I feel like I am the character, and I think that's why Village Attacks works and why I love the minis for Village Attacks, is because I am the monster. And so in that case, I like the mini. If it's, oh, these are just generic armies, generic units, give me cubes, give me standees, give me something that's easy to move. I don't have any attachment to them. And I think that's the difference, at least for me. Okay. All right, that takes care of Ryan's question. All right. A Godzilla game would be sweet. I actually came up with an idea for a Godzilla game once upon a time. We still have the pitch sheet somewhere. Mistborn House War specifically. Richard, if you're talking about the game that I think we could definitely do better, yeah. I was, again, personal opinion, I was not impressed with House War. I think that House War has a significant flaw that we stumbled upon the first time we played it. I'm not going to go into too many details because I don't like bashing people's games here. And I know it's not bashing, it's me providing a critique, but I don't like doing that too much here. But I do think that the game does have a fundamental flaw because you usually hedge your bets, like whether you want to be positive or negative, because you can get positive or negative points. And depending upon the end game condition will change whether whoever has the most points wins or whoever has the fewest points wins. So for the entire point of the game, you're kind of hedging your bets positive or negative. And then if you think you're the most negative or you think you're the most positive, usually throw your weight behind that end game condition when you're in that situation. That's the idea, or at least that's what it seems like the idea is from the design. And I think that idea is awesome. However, the fundamental flaw we ran into was somebody went out on turn one and deliberately started taking negative points. And then just started collecting all the negative points they could. And we were in a four-player game. So now this entire core hook of the game has been removed because we now think that that one person is going to try to push it negative. And the other three of us know we can't possibly catch up to them on negative points. So we're now competing on positive points. And the three of us are determined to make it positive or to play Kingmaker if we don't think we're winning. And that's where I feel like it was flawed. I think that if you don't have that type of player in the game works much better. I think that then in that case, it will work as intended. But we had someone who deliberately and publicly went negative. And like I said, it kind of removed the hook from the game. So, okay. Let's see, Jared, I told me about the Demon Cycle books, through all of them. Oh, you did go through the Demon Cycle books. Okay, then Jared, it's not a spoiler for you. Plug your ears if you think you ever want to read this series. It's a really quick thing. It's just one sentence. I just was disappointed in the ending. Felt flat. Loved the series though. Just that one little thing. So... okay, Ryan, would I, if I could, turn any of my books into a board game? Not yet. Bluntly, I don't think I have written one that I would be happy with being a board game yet. It's something that I would like to do someday. Absolutely, hands down, I think it would be amazing. But I don't think I have any good candidates right now. I don't think that any of the books that I've written or have scoped out would make for a good board game yet. Not yet. Stay tuned. Okay. You're welcome, B. I am glad to help. Let's see. Linear, thinking of the Stormlight Archive. An interesting concept would be a different bridge queues competing to reach the gem heart, a race game with obstacles. That does sound like a good idea. Okay. Everybody knows Monopoly would be nothing without minis. Yeah, that's why I have 8 copies of Monopoly. I don't have any copies of Monopoly. I will not begrudge someone for enjoying Monopoly. I will not. I'm a firm believer in don't shame people for things that they like. I firmly believe that. What I am a big proponent of is I will say Monopoly is not a good game. And I will say that if you dislike games and all you've played is Monopoly, let me at least show you a different game. Those stances I will take. Okay, so Ryan, do you paint your minis? I do not. I wish I did. Now, let me rephrase that. I wish my minis were painted. I don't wish I painted them. I wish they were painted. I am not joking that I have. At certain times in my life, when I played specific games a lot more, and when I had more time, I have looked at the possibility of hiring someone to paint minis from my games because I would love to have painted minis. I just don't want to do the painting. I'm not very good at it, first of all, and I'll openly admit that. I don't have an eye for color. I don't have an eye for like blending and things like that. And I openly admit this. Like the joke is that we frequently say on the team, I am not the art person. Josh will show me like first rough drafts, and I'll be like, that is awesome. Let's go to print. And he will just look at me like I'm crazy and be like, it's a line draft. It is nowhere near ready for print. And I'm like, I don't know, it looks good to me. Yeah, so I am not an art person. So no, I do not paint my minis, but I do wish my minis were painted. However, my partner does paint minis, and I have this little mini of Sif on not our Sif, but if you've played Dark Souls, you'll recognize Sif with the giant sword. So I do have this mini of Sif that she painted, which is awesome and much better than the pewter gray it was. It's even got blue eyes. I don't know how well that shows up on the camera. And the sword, like she looked at the playthrough videos to see what it looked like and then painted it appropriate colors. And that is awesome. There's a reason it's on my desk. So yes, I enjoy painted minis and I would love to have them painted, but I don't paint. And if I had a lot more money than I do, I might commission someone to paint them, but I don't. I would rather spend that money on getting another new game than getting a batch of minis painted, let's be real. But yeah, if I ever make it like, ridiculously rich, which will probably never happen, but if I ever do, I will definitely hire someone to paint my minis, hands down. Or I will like on the Kickstarters go for like the $500 add-on, which is like painted minis. I've seen that on a couple of them. I wish I could remember, but I remember there was like one Kickstarter from a while ago that was like, oh yeah, if you throw in an extra $500, you'll get, and it was like a limited edition because they didn't want to like totally kill their painter, but they were like, yeah, then one of the artists will hand paint all of your minis. And I'm not gonna lie that even in my current financial situation, I considered it. I don't have anywhere near enough money for it to justify that. But I'm not gonna lie, I did consider it because I was like, oh, that would be so cool. Have them all show up painted. And I really don't remember what Kickstarter it was. I mean, it doesn't matter in the grand scheme of things, but I just thought it was funny. And it was very appropriate to your question. Richard, you did the Kickstarter for Mistborn, but you haven't had a chance to bring it to the table. Yeah, I played it at BGG. I didn't even know it went on Kickstarter. I would have backed it in an instant. But when I saw it come out and I saw it come to BGG, I was like, ooh, I got to play this. And I was all excited for it. And then I was kind of let down because of the experience that I shared earlier. So, but I know other people who have it and really enjoy it. Because remember, every gamer is different. Whenever I give you an opinion, remember that's my opinion of a game. So, Ryan, would I commission Josh? I just answered that without even seeing that question. Awesome. Jared, not a fan of Monopoly despite having at least 5 copies. Yeah, I can understand how they can become collector's items, and I can understand like how you want to hold on to them, especially with like some of the themed ones. Totally get that, and especially if there's like a nostalgia value. Like here, I'll give you my nostalgia value game. I'm an anti-pack rat, right? Well, I mean, you probably didn't know that, but I am, which means that I frequently get rid of things in my house that I'm not using, that don't serve a purpose. There's a reason why there's not a lot of art on my walls. Like, I'm pretty Spartan, and I admit that. And, like, I don't have a lot of stuff. It bugs me. So there's not a lot of things that I hold on to for, like, sentimental value or something like that. However, I do have an entire second edition Talisman board game. And when I say entire, I mean including the Dragons expansion, which was only ever released in England. I found a copy of it online on eBay because, you know, hey, eBay. Back in the day, that was, you know, how you got things that were impossible to find. I guess it still is. I just don't hear about it very often. So yes, I have an entire second edition of Talisman in, I'd say, very good condition. Like, it's not excellent condition. It's not near new. It's definitely not new. It has been played. I've played it. But I would say that it's still considered very good condition. Yeah, and actually the last time I checked on eBay, and this is back when I was in college, I think, or it was shortly after college. Okay, yeah, Talisman's Dragons itself is on eBay right now for pre-owned $250. That is what it is currently going for. Timescape City Dungeon Adventure and Dragons, all of them together, all of which I have, including the core game, which wasn't listed in that list, is $900 on eBay right now. Needless to say, these things are hard to find and very rare, and there's a bunch of people who really like them. And I refuse to get rid of it because I have this like huge nostalgia connection to it. It was a game that I played to death when I was growing up. Like when I was really young, I used to go into the basement and my parents had these milk crates of games. And I would go into the basement and I would pull out a game and I would read the rules, learn how to play, and I'd usually play by myself. Sometimes I would try to convince my brother or my parents to play with me, but usually I would play a game by myself. And Talisman became the game that we would all play a lot. And we played every single character. And then once I played it and introduced the group to it or the family to it, then they got the expansions. And we actually had, we just had the basic Talisman, Talisman the Expansion, and Talisman Adventure. Just those three. And I think, well, I know that we got rid of them. And I think I did. Not 100% sure, but I know that at some point they were gotten rid of. I don't remember when, I don't remember where. I'm willing to take responsibility for that because I'm reasonably sure that my mother would have given it to me knowing how much I enjoyed it and how much I played it. So I'm reasonably sure that that is on me, but I'm not 100% sure. But anyway, whatever. It doesn't matter. it was gotten rid of. And then I got a hankering for it when I was in college. And so I hunted down each of the expansions and the core book one by one, looking for really either like new or new versions of it on eBay and like in game stores and stuff like that, and hunted them all down, including Dragons, until I have a full set. And I don't think I've played it in almost 20 years, but I still have it and I refuse to get rid of it. Although I did get rid of all of the extra boxes. So it is all just like in one or two, because it's too much stuff, just in two boxes. So it is the full thing. It's not as valuable to collectors, but I was always like, I'm not keeping it because I'm a collector. I'm keeping it because I like it and because I have this attachment to it. So that's one of the few things that I still have for nostalgia purposes. And that's like, it's not a great game. It's really long and very luck-based, but I have a lot of fond memories of it. So I guess I'm saying that that is similar to me understanding why people will hold on to lots of copies of Monopoly. I totally get it. Totally understand how it can have that type of connection. So do I still have board space for board games in my flat? Well, yes. Yes, I do. mainly because I expanded the amount of space that I'm allowed to have. So I have the really, really cool board game shelves called Box Thrones. Oh my gosh, I love them so much. They are so awesome. Here, I'm going to get a link for you. You can check this out at your leisure. But I am spoiled. I backed those on Kickstarter. And whoa, those are wonderful. Those are awesome. I'm the kind of guy who hated starting the game sideways because all the pieces would fall. Like, oh, that just drives me nuts. So I always wanted to store them flat, but stacking them on top of one another and putting them in giant stacks was like terrifying and would even crush some of the boxes. So this solution, awesome, perfect, love it. I bought a full set and then moved all my games over to it. And it was kind of funny because I used to be limited by space and I had two shelves which were full of games up to the ceiling. And then I got these Box Thrones, but the Box Thrones actually add a little bit of space between each game. Not much. Like if you click on that link and see their little video, you'll see that there's not a lot of space between the games. But if you were already at the roof, that is enough space where now all of the games couldn't fit. So at the time I justified it as, okay, well, I didn't get any more games, so I'm going to allow myself to get another couple of Box Throne shelves. And I did. And now that space has been filling up with games. It hasn't hit the roof yet. But when that's full, we're going to have a problem, because then that's like four Box Thrones worth, four pillars and the space in between full of games. And if all of my Kickstarter board games that I have backed got delivered tomorrow, it would be overflowing. So yeah, there might be a problem. There might be a little problem. Okay. So Ryan, you recently bought a game on eBay that you played with your granddad from 1992 called Ghostly Galleon. Oh, wow. That's awesome. I remember like looking through and getting some really old games like on eBay and stuff when I was doing the whole nostalgia thing, like Battlemasters and Crossbows and Catapults. That was a big one. I played that one a lot as a kid and then never had it again, and then got it again as an adult, and have since gotten rid of it because I was like, I'm not going to play it. Again, that whole anti-pack rat thing. There is a, like, I specifically do say that there's Talisman is the only board game that has had enough nostalgia that I kept it. Like that anti-pack rat thing is very strong for me. But yeah, no, I went through this phase where I was like, oh, Crossbows and Catapults, oh, Battlemasters, and like got all of them. And yeah, so I understand. And that is awesome, Ryan. I appreciate that. Okay, Linear, would I find it interesting to take an old game such as Talisman and see how I could improve? Be great to see new, revised, and updated versions of classics. So, possibly. That becomes fraught with a whole bunch of problems. There's legal problems and there's nostalgia problems with that. So let's talk about this real quick. So, like, the legal problems are the fact that you can only update a game if you have the rights to the game. And most of the games, because of the way copyrights and whatnot work, are still under copyright, which means that you either need to approach or be approached by the copyright holder, which is usually the publisher. So it's not something that, like, we at Linbender are just going to do, like, oh, I want to do an updated version of Talisman. Let's do it. Let's make an updated version and let's pitch it to FFG. Because you know what? If FFG says no, and it's really tied into Talisman, that's a lot of wasted work. We don't like to do wasted work. We don't have enough time to do the work we have. We don't want to do wasted work. So that's problem number one. Problem number two is nostalgia is a tricky beast. And you can actually see this if you look at some of the video games and some of the board games that have been re-released and updated. Sometimes people say they want an updated game, but their feelings when they play an updated one are not positive. They're like, oh, well, it wasn't like the original. And so it's a very, very tricky line to cross because some people will be genuinely upset that you changed certain things. Even if you think, and even if like reviewers think that these were improvements, if you change how like a fundamental thing in the game works, there's a good chance there's going to be people who will go into that and be disappointed in how it's not the same thing. I mean, oh, from the movies, a wonderful example of this is the Star Wars movies. How many people were upset about the new Star Wars? Like, it wasn't a bad, like, I personally liked them, but like, there are a lot of people who are really upset about the new Star Wars. Some for good reasons, some for not so good reasons. But the core thing here is that nostalgia is a very tricky thing to play with. And so that is very dangerous territory. What I would much rather do is I would rather do just like you know how movies have like based on the book, whatever, and then they have inspired by the book, whatever. I would much rather do inspired by. I would much rather do spiritual successors rather than a re-release because I think that that is a lot less dangerous territory, and that also gives me a lot more flexibility to be creative. And yes, I absolutely agree with your comment about probably better to take aspects of a classic game you like and incorporate it into a new game. We do that all the time. Whether we know it or not, we do that all the time. All right, well, we are coming up on the hour. And thank you very much for being here and having questions. Not gonna lie, I was a little worried that I'd come in, get through my like opening spiel for 10 minutes, and it would be like dead silent. And I'd be like, all right, I'm gonna hang around for 5 minutes and talk about something random until I sign off. So I appreciate you being here. I appreciate you having questions for me. Like I said, this was a little different. I'll probably do this again sometime in the future, not for a while. Just because like this isn't obviously the format that I want to have all the time, because I know that some people come here specifically to hear about design, but I'll do this again since people seemed to have questions and enjoy it. Thank you very much. Play some games, have fun, and I will talk with you later. Take care, everyone.